So any of you, you've done antenatal scans, right? And you have seen hydronephrosis and antenatal scans, right? So it's always confusing what to do when you see hydronephrosis antenatally, right? Whether postnatally, do you need an ultrasound or not? What is normal? What is abnormal? So sometimes it's obvious. There are PU valves, you'll see them. There's a lot of PUG obstruction or something. It's very obvious. If it's mild to moderate, you're not sure. It can be physiologic. It can be because of reflux. Reflux can often decrease on its own, but sometimes it needs antibiotics. A lot of confusion on what to do. So the Society for Fetal Urology, SFU, created guidelines on classifying hydronephrosis postnatally. So if you see an obstetric ultrasound, you see antenatal hydronephrosis postnatally. Once you do a scan in the bachu, how do you classify hydronephrosis? Based on the SFU grading of hydronephrosis, the management of the bachu will change. So it's technically not a journal club in a sense. It's more of a white paper than really an original article, but I think it's something you should know. So this is like when I was in the US, all reports would have SFU grade when they talked of fetal hydronephrosis. Okay, or sorry, bachu hydronephrosis. Okay, so let's start.
So my presentation is based upon an article published in July 2010 by the Journal of Pediatric Urology. The Society for Fetal Urology consensus a statement on the evaluation and management of the antenatal hydronephrosis. So ANH, it's the dilatation of the renal collecting system, right? So it's the most common abnormality detected in prenatal ultrasound, which comprises in 1 to 5% of all the pregnancies. So ANH is, when ANH is there, it represents there is some urological condition. It can be either transient hydronephrosis or there can be some significant urinary tract obstruction or vesicoureteric reflux. So with the advent of prenatal ultrasound, why this SFU has come up with the recommendations and management guidelines? Because so that we can detect these conditions prior to the development of complications such as urinary tract infection, renal dysfunction or failure, right? The methodology is, it's a literature search. They search the different articles reporting on children with prenatal hydronephrosis and their postnatal evaluation from 1993 to July 2009, and they excluded the article that were only contained non-human subjects, editorials, etc. So they summarized and made the general recommendations based upon the current available clinical evidences. They didn't go for any meta-analysis of the literature other than those were reported.
So essentially what this is a white, you know what is a white paper, what is the difference between a white paper and a review article, for example? So white paper is more of a consensus document. So you get experts in your field, right? So most likely in, if you look at their author list, there will be experts in the field of fetal ultrasound, fetal urology, there will be radiologists, also be urologists, nephrologists, etc, etc. They all comment it together. It is not a meta-analysis, meaning it is not a scientific review of all the literature available till now. It's more of an opinion. So these experts sit and they read all the articles on that subject. Then they say, based on what we have read and based on what we think, feel or we have experienced, this is the best way to go forward for such a thing. So that is a white paper. Compared with that, meta-analysis is an actual scientific analysis. You will pull all the data from all the papers you have read. If there are 10 papers all having 100 subjects and you have 1000 subjects ka data and you analyze it, that is meta-analysis. In a white paper, you don't analyze, you just read them, you quote them, but then you give recommendations based on what you feel or what you believe and in consensus, okay?
Yeah, so this picture shows the normal appearance of the kidney on ultrasound. So this is the renal cortex, this is the renal sinus, this dark hypoechoic pyramid-like structure is the renal pyramid. Should not be mistaken for collateral dilatation. We can see kidneys by 12th to 13th week of gestation, and the distinct renal structure will be seen by 20th week, but the maturation will continue throughout the gestation. While we are screening the antenatal abdomen, we find so many cystic structures like small bowel, colon. So how to identify bladder? When any cystic structure is seen in between two umbilical arteries, it is bladder. We can see bladder at 10th to 14th week, and the capacity will range from 10 cc at 30th week and 50 cc at term.
You don't really measure volume in bladder, right? Generally, just it's a visual thing. You just have to see whether it's present or absent. If you don't see the bladder, you have to wait again for half an hour and then call the patient again. This is an obstetric ultrasound, okay?
Yeah, so assessment of ANH. Prenatally, when we are assessing outro, we measure the anteroposterior diameter of the renal pelvis in the transverse plane. So basically, it's a surrogate marker that there is some potential disease, but it won't identify the exact pathological condition. The disadvantage is the ultrasound is subjective, so there will be different intra-observer variability, and it only measures the anteroposterior diameter of the pelvis, renal pelvis. Won't consider the calyceal dilatation or the renal parenchymal changes, such as increase in the echogenicity or parenchymal thinning. So by using APD, we can classify ANH in different grades, like mild, moderate, and severe. The diameter will it's different in second and third trimester. So when the APD is more than 4 mm, but it is less than 7 mm, so it's a mild ANH. But when it goes beyond 10 mm, it will be severe. Similarly, in third trimester, when the diameter of interposterior diameter is more than 7 mm, but it's less than 9 mm, it's a mild hydronephrosis. But when it goes beyond 15 mm, it's a severe. Between 9 and 15, it will be moderate.
Okay, so this is antenatal. So till now, what we have talked is obstetric ultrasound. When you see the bachu and there's hydronephrosis there, you grade it based on the anteroposterior dimension, right? And she rightly said the limitation. It does not talk of anything beyond diameter. So nothing about renal parenchymal effects, etc., etc. So it's a nice way to standardize things, and you know, because it's, you just have to keep it basic. But once the bachu is born, then you have to do something more complicated or more detailed than just APD.
Yeah, so the Society for Fetal Urology, they proposed a 5-point numerical grading system based upon the postnatal. Once the baby is born postnatally, the appearance of the renal pelvis, calyceal system and the renal parenchyma. Based upon that, they gave the 5-point numerical grading. The grade 0 is like normal, absolutely normal, ranging from grade 1 where there is a barely splitting of the renal sinus to the grade 4 where we get some parenchymal changes. So grade 0 is absolutely normal kidney where there is no splitting of the renal sinus. Grade 1, you can see between these two echogenic lines there is anechoic line, so it's a barely splitting of the renal sinus, which is grade 1. Grade 2 is still the major calyceal dilatation. So these are different USG variants which demonstrate. Here we can see the pelvis is dilated. Here also there is a pelvis dilated, but here you can see it goes beyond the pelvis, including the major calyces. So these two images demonstrate the major calyceal system dilatation.
And so grade 1 is only very thin linear pelvis. If you see anything more than that, it is grade 2. Or if you see the major calyces also, it is grade 2. It sometimes gets difficult to be sure. You know, for example, in this photo, are the minor calyces also a little dilated? So sometimes if you see a little bit of extra dilatation, then you're not sure, then grade 2 and grade 3 should be next. So it's a little subjective still.
In this picture, in addition to grade 2, there is a dilatation of the minor calyces. So here you can see the dilatation goes till the apex of the pyramid. So it is including the minor calyces. But the parenchyma is preserved. So it's grade 3. In grade 4, there will be parenchymal changes. In addition to calyceal system dilatation, there will be parenchymal thinning. So to summarize, grade 0 is normal, grade 2 there's a grade 1 is barely splitting of the renal sinus, grade 2 is still the major calyces, grade 3 is minor calyces also dilated, but the parenchymal changes won't occur. In grade 4 there will be parenchymal thinning. So why we need to know this grading? Based upon this grading system, we are going to manage this patient accordingly. To know the etiology of ANH, in ultrasound we will screen the kidney, ureter, bladder. So in this picture you can see there is a hydronephrosis in prenatal period, but it gets resolved in the postnatal ultrasound. So while it's related to a narrowing of uretropelvic junction, the natural kinks and folds that occur in the early development. But when baby matures, this will go away as the hydronephrosis. So it's a transient thing, which is quite common. It is seen in 40 to 88%. It's quite common. It's not a pathological condition. So here in this image, you can see the kidney where the pelvis is dilated, major calcium system is dilated, but the ureter is not dilated. So there is some obstruction between the pelvis and the ureter at the junction. So it's a uretropelvic junction obstruction, where you can see the pelvic calcium system dilatation without ureteral dilatation. Here you can see there is a dilatation of the ureter and pelvis as well as major calyces are also dilated. So you can suspect there is obstruction somewhere in the lower urinary tract. So we'll screen bladder in this patient. If bladder is normal, so there is obstruction somewhere at the junction of the bladder and the ureter. So it's a uretrovesical junction obstruction where you see the ureteral dilatation with the bladder. No, sir. It is the kidney. Vesicoureteric junction obstruction. Here, which appearance is this? Yeah, keyhole. So it's bladder is dilated, posterior urethra is dilated, and the hydroureter nephrosis we can see. So this condition is often bilateral and dilated posterior urethra. So this is either urethral atresia or posterior urethral valves. The next condition is vesicoureteric reflux. There is no such findings that definitively diagnose there is vesicoureteric reflux. But finding of a variable degree of hydronephrosis or hydroureter nephrosis, that may suggest the possibility of vesicoureteric reflux. In this scan, we can see there is a changing in the degree of hydronephrosis. Here there is a lesser than the one we can see here. So changing in the degree of hydronephrosis may suggest the possibility of vesicoureteric reflux.
So this is essentially the most important one in the sense. This is why the grading was there. Because see, the others is very straightforward, right? PU valve, you know what to do. You will diagnose an ultrasound and then treat it, right? UVG obstruction, mega ureter, again, you will be relatively fine diagnosing, although this can be confused with reflux. UVG obstruction, very straightforward. This will resolve, right? So you don't really worry about it. So it's essentially mainly for this when you don't know what to do. Should we give antibiotics? It's not easy to give a child antibiotics year long, right? It's just a very painful situation for the parents. So this is where the grading is mainly useful. But you essentially give it in every bachu wherever you see hydronephrosis.
Yeah, and other uncommon causes like multicystic dysplastic kidney, uretrocyte, Prun-Belly syndrome, etc. So the recommendations of USG prenatally. So once we know that baby is having antenatal hydronephrosis, how are we going to assess this patient antenatally? So when in second trimester we are finding that there is a mild hydronephrosis, we may consider this patient for third trimester ultrasound. But if it is moderate, then this patient should be assessed in third trimester for the follow-up scan. In case of severe hydronephrosis where there is a more than 10 mm of APD, then we have to repeat the ultrasound in 3 to 4 weeks. Similarly, in third trimester, mild to moderate hydronephrosis, we should do postnatal ultrasound. In case of severe, we should repeat the ultrasound 2 to 3 weeks, because since these patients are having more chance of urological conditions and they may need some surgical intervention like vesicoamniotic shunting, or they may need like oligohydramnios and all progresses, so induction of the labor and all. So we need to closely follow up these patients at 2 to 3 weeks. Different imaging modalities and evaluation of ANS. So most commonly we use renal ultrasound.
This is after the bachu is born. So once the bachu is born, what can you do? You can do one of these or more than one of these.
So it's inexpensive, no radiation, no contrast, administration, nothing. The second is voiding cystourethrogram. When we are suspecting some lower urinary tract pathology like PUG, like posterior urethral walls, or vesicoureteric reflux like bladder diverticulum or ureteroseal, all these conditions will be diagnosed on voiding cystourethrogram. The next is renal scintigraphy, where we use radioactive substances like DMSA, DTPA, MAC3. All these will estimate the differential renal function and severity of obstruction. This will do at the 6 weeks where the kidney is matured. The other is MR urography. It's not that much used, but to look for anatomy when the anatomy is not clear, in other investigation we do MR urography. How do we evaluate ANH, anterior hydronephrosis, postnatally, and what are the management recommendations? So, when the baby is of unilateral hydronephrosis, if severe unilateral hydronephrosis, as the baby is born, we immediately start the antibiotic to prevent the urinary tract infection. Hydronephrosis is the most common cause for UTI. So to prevent this UTI, we immediately start the prophylactic antibiotics. Whatever will be the SFU grade postnatal ultrasound, we will do further investigation like voiding cystourethrogram to look for any urological pathology and closely follow up this patient at 3 to 6 months. Similarly, in moderate, if it has resolved, first the baby is born, we will start the antibiotic. But in postnatal ultrasound, within 2 to 4 weeks, if it has resolved, we'll stop the antibiotic and follow up this patient at 1 year. But still there is some hydronephrosis like ranging from grade 1 to 4. We'll do further investigations just like voiding cystourethrogram and closely follow up this patient. In case of mild hydronephrosis, no need for prophylactic antibiotic. If it is resolved, we won't do any investigation, follow up this patient after 1 year. But if hydronephrosis persists, like mild hydronephrosis, like 1 to 2 grade SFU, then we may or may not do further investigation and follow up this patient 1 year. But if patient is symptomatic and hydronephrosis progresses in further follow-up, then we need to do further investigations like voiding cystourethrogram. But mild hydronephrosis, when it progresses to moderate to severe, then we will do further investigations and follow up this patient closely. Similarly, it was about the unilateral condition, like unilateral, mild, moderate, severe. But if it is bilateral, severe and moderate hydronephrosis, we need to do ultrasound within 48 weeks of the after the birth, 48 hours of the after the birth, and start the antibiotics immediately. We'll do voiding cystourethrogram in 1 to 7 days. If VUR is there, vesicoureteric reflux, we'll continue the antibiotic. If posterior urethral valve is there, we will consider this patient for surgery. But any of these conditions are not there. Like voiding cystourethrogram will identify majority of the lower urinary tract conditions. But if it is not there and hydronephrosis is still there, then we'll do renal scintigraphy. It will be done at 6 weeks where the kidney is matured, and we'll see the differential renal function. Like if it is less than 40% and the impaired drainage and all is there, then we will consider this patient for pyeloplasty and some UPG, PUG obstruction and all. So these patients, we need to do renal scintigraphy, and depending upon the pathology, we'll follow up this patient. Yeah. So similarly, in urethral abnormalities like diverticulum, bladder wall thickening, ureteroseal, dilated posterior urethra, will screen this patient in 1 to 3 days after the birth, and will do further investigations to look for urological conditions, and depending upon the pathology, will follow up this patient. That's it. Thank you. Thank you.
So whenever you give your report, if you see a bachu, so immediate postnatal bachu, it is not for a 2-year-old kid. Immediate postnatal, you should always give the SFU grade. And when such bachus are followed up even later on in life, then you should again keep giving the SFU grade, right? Because most of them will actually be here. They'll be this most commonly. SFU 1, 2 is the most common thing you'll see, and sometimes you'll see 3, 4. And essentially, there will be patients who have probable reflux. So that's the most common group you'll see. So just be careful about this grading and use it in a routine practice. Okay. Good. Very good job.